Nightmare Range. The Collected George Sueño and Ernie Bascom Stories by Martin Limon. Narrated by Timothy Andrés Pabon. Introduction by Timothy Hallinan. Cool and hot. Yes and no. Head and shoulders. Matter and antimatter. Laurel and Hardy. Sueño and Bascom. Martin Limon has created my favorite crime-solving team since, and perhaps including, Holmes and Watson. He's taken a perfectly balanced union of opposites and put them into a whole landscape of opposites. Army grunts versus Army brass. The rigidity and pragmatism of the U.S. Eighth Army versus the truculence and tradition of Korean officialdom. On a larger scale, the permanent war between North and South Korea. It's in the intermittently neutral spaces between all these grinding jaws that Limon sets the stories in which George Sueño and Ernie Bascom right wrongs caused by crime, betrayal, stupidity, misunderstanding, prejudice, drugs, and heartbreak. This is American-occupied Cold War South Korea, long after the armistice that resolved nothing and long before the miracle explosion of the economy. So in addition to all the other opposites in Limon's books and stories, we have a vast economic and political division between haves and have-nots, between the powerful and the weak. Martin Limon owns this world in a way that very few writers can claim their setting and characters. He learned it firsthand, over the course of a decade spent with the Army in Korea. Like George Sueño, he opened himself to Korean culture and learned the language. Like Ernie Bascom, who will walk through a wall when it's the shortest distance between two points, he developed a healthy loathing for the cover-your-ass obstructionism of Army procedure. So he had the experience to tell these stories. But hundreds of thousands of people graduated from that same school of experience, and none of them came up with George and Ernie. None of them came up with the AWOL soldiers in the Bill. None of them came up with the tragically exploited working girls, the Army's boneheaded officers and lost boys, the hard-eyed Korean cops, the whole landscape of want and desperation, invisibly layered with a rich and deeply spiritual culture thousands of years old. And that's because Martin Limon is a writer of the very first rank. He's a poet of the people, although without the political connotations that phrase might suggest. He looks at people of at least two cultures and at every level, and he sees all the way through them, and then he uses his gifts to put them on the page so fully the reader feels that he or she can walk around them. And then, sometimes, he allows them to be broken into tiny pieces, and as we readers retreat to our fundamental conceptions of right and wrong and our comfortable certainty that right will prevail, George and Ernie's investigation reminds us forcefully that in this particular world, that's often not the case. Sometimes tiny victories are the only ones in sight, and sometimes you have to search even for those. I discovered Limon when his first novel, The Astonishing Jade Lady Burning, came out. I waited, often impatiently, for each succeeding book. It got to the point where all I had to do was open the cover to smell the charcoal cookers, feel the cold, see the eyes of the people, almost know what was around the corner, because the world Limon creates is so consistent, so thoroughly known, in a way that only the very best writers' fictional worlds are. If you think of, say, a prose description of a street as the point of view of a camera that's been placed there, Limon is one of those rare writers who could tell you instantly what's behind the camera and what's out of view to the right and the left. He can do the same with the internal landscape of his characters. I soon learned to put aside a big chunk of time when the new Martin Limon novel finally landed in my lap, because I wasn't going to be home, or any place close to home, until I'd finished it. When I set out to write my own books about the emotional and spiritual collision between two cultures, Martin Limon was my primary inspiration. In thinking about my books, I read Limon not for events or characters or tropes, but for the particular wizardry with which he keeps the larger perspective in view, even while he's got his reader at the level of details. When we see a movie, we're rarely conscious of the lens the director has chosen, even though it can have a huge impact on how we see the scene.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.